As mentioned in the report earlier, the president is expected to leave the country later this afternoon for his fifth and sixth trip just in the first 3 months of 2024. What do you make out of the frequency of his overseas travels?
From a strategic point of view, I see value in the president's trip, especially as they choose key countries that could be stronger, that could lead to stronger partnership, stronger alliances that can help address not only security challenges, but even economic challenges that we are facing right now as a country.
All right. Dindo, it's no secret that President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. has been trying to diversify the Philippines' alliances, especially with the U.S. coming to a vote in October or in November later this year. There's quite an uncertainty there on who the next U.S. president will be. Make sense of the situation for the public. How important are these state visits and these working and official visits for the Philippines at a time when the country is trying to defend itself against Chinese incursions?
I've always viewed the world, Kat, from a different point of view. I don't like to look at it from the interest of the U.S., but also from the interest of, more so, especially for the interest of the Philippine people. And right now, as President Marcos expands, grows our partnerships and alliances with countries that share the values of democracy, that shares the value of a rules-based international order, that is ready to help us not only security-wise, but even economic-wise with either investments, trade, or even opening up of their country to more Philippine workers. If you remember, remittances drive our Philippine economy also. So I see that as a different point of view, that the president and his cabinet is looking at it from a more strategic direction. And in this strategic direction, we see value on the importance of the Philippines right now because we are key to international trade. We are key to the security, stability of the South China Sea and the Indo-Pacific region.
All right, Dindo, policymakers and academics know the system well, but ordinary Filipinos need some explanation on why these diplomatic relations cannot simply be strengthened over a phone call.
You know, you'll be surprised that when people are saying that there are groups that's against the Philippine president, our institute is data-driven, and we have not seen lower support for the president. We have seen up to 90% of Filipinos wanting him to assert our rights. And just at the end of last year, we see at least 70 to 80% of Filipinos would like us to strengthen our relationship with these countries. You know, like Australia continues to be a top country, US, Japan, the European Union. So there is broad support. I think the Filipinos understand it, and again, at the end of the day, it's quantitative studies that we try to do twice a year of these issues that drive our analysis. And there is support because Filipinos understand, maybe in a you'd say simpler words, that to protect our national security, there should be economic security. So a good balance between generating trade, investment, opening up of countries to more Filipino workers, for our OFW families, can create a stronger national security position for our government on the long term.
All right. Dindo, since you already mentioned foreign investments, as of December 2023, the government says that the president's foreign trips has generated about 4 trillion pesos in investments involving 148 projects in different sectors. But is this amount actually enough to justify the frequency of the president's travels, considering that Malacanang has yet to publicize the breakdown of their spending?
The data that you're referring to, I think if you would look at tradition, yearly tradition, we await, and I think it's by March when we see the foreign direct investment as of 2023. So we can break it down at the time. But right now, you have to understand, and I'd like to be a little critical of the past administration here, there were lack of interest on the part of the Philippines when we had a different administration. I'm referring to the Duterte administration. But now we should see value that countries are interested to talk to the president. And these are countries and their head of governments and head of states that are inviting our government. So we should see value. Why are they interested? with us. Maybe they see something positive. So I don't think we should contribute and look only for the negative side. Because the reality is the world, as we see all these trips, these are not being generated by the government. This is being generated actually by the other side. The invitation from Australia, the invitation from the Czech Republic, the invitation from Germany, the biggest economy in the European Union, the visit this coming week of a group of business leaders led by the Secretary of Commerce of the U.S. There's interest in the Philippines. And I see value because at the end of the day, when our government generates interest, it could generate investment and jobs. Of course, the challenging side is transforming it into actual investment. That's where the bureaucracy also comes in. Are they allowing or helping the Department of Trade and Industry as they try to generate this investment to turn it into actual jobs for our country? Because that, you know, our problem is we have always been driven by consumption-driven economy. But we can sustain and make our economy stronger if we can not only build our economy, not only on consumption, but on investment. I call it an investment-led growth. And I'm hoping that this travel, as she continues, as the president continues to take these trips, engages, creates this opportunity to transform our economy on a long term, in a more strategic value for us.
Right. Dindo, the presence of the Philippines in international stages, there's no question to that. But the question of the public is more about this, on whether or not the administration is actually spending judiciously taxpayers' money. Take, for example, the president could fly abroad with perhaps a smaller contingent at that. That's the problem. That's the question that a lot of people are asking, especially online. My question to you, what can Malacañang actually... No, ma'am. This is my question after that very long premise. What can Malacañang actually do to ease worries and impressions that the president is just jet-setting around the world, spending tax people's money?
You're talking to a political scientist. Online comments are not... We don't take that seriously. What we take seriously is regular quantitative data that we run nationally, not only us, but also other survey firms. And I know a lot of survey firms have run at the end of the year that at least 70% of Filipinos believe that we are on the right direction. So online comments are not as powerful as a source of public opinion in our country. I hope you understand, because you're talking to not a propagandist, but a political scientist like me. But for our purposes, I think there's a misunderstanding. When the president travels with the private sector, my understanding through the years, and this is that the private sector travels and pays for their trip. So the president simply travels with the contingent of government officials. That is what is paid by the public in terms of expenditure of government. So we should go into those details more and maybe ask.
Right, but I think it's also quite important for the palace to know on why wives of certain cabinet figures are included in those trips, their relevance to those trips.
Yes, you cannot. The wives cannot be paid by government. That will go against government procurement rules, and that cabinet member will be charged with misappropriation of public funds. So maybe it's good to ask the cabinet or ask those government to define that. Because if ever their spouses travel with them, that should be paid by private money.
Right. So perhaps a more transparent
policy. It's not my expertise, Kat. So I'm just saying, my simple understanding of public spending, you cannot charge the trips of individuals who are not government officials.
So perhaps a more transparent policy would not hurt?
Yes, that's what I'm saying. So instead of us focusing on that weakness of the trips, I think we should see value on these trips. And if we want greater transparency, which is very important, even I think with this host government that invite the president, they don't like that kind of misappropriation of funds when the president travels also. I'm referring to countries that invite.
All
it's
right.
Good to demand for transparency and accountability on that issue, but we should not veer away from the importance of these trips. The strategic value, you know, just like the trip in Australia, I was hoping that media would have given so much interest that only a few head of state have spoken in the Australian Parliament. That's a very positive step. Why is it being offered by the Australian government? But we did not spend time on that. We spent time on comments of small little groups there in Australia. So we have to give importance because we are. I am leading an institute, which that's why we call ourselves a strategic institute. We look at a broader point of view and we see the strategic value of the Philippines and the importance of the Philippines today that we have seen before 2016. We are on a catch up because for 6 years, the world did not know where we stand in this rules-based international order. The world did not understand why we are not asserting our rights. Now they are saying that they should be more focused on working with us, helping our government attain, protect national security side by side with economic security.
Right. And speaking of Australia, Dindo, talk to us. What did the Philippines actually gain from that back-to-back visits in a span of a week, aside from having the stage for the president to talk about his policy with regard to the Philippines' stance on the West Philippine Sea?
Australia is an important partner of the Philippines. For more than decades, we have had what we call the Status of Visiting Forces Agreement. And with Australia also, he has this alliance and partnership with the United Kingdom and the U.S. in terms of ensuring peace and stability, what they call the AUKUS, in both the Pacific Islands and the South China Sea. We know that Australia is one of the leading nations in what some would call quadrilateral, that means four countries of Australia, Japan, India, and the U.S. in protecting and ensuring peace and stability in the Indo-Pacific region. So they play a key role. And Australia, this trip represented how important the Philippines is because they invited the Philippine government ahead of the ASEAN. So you have to understand the trip separately. There is this strong engagement by Australia with ASEAN nations, which happened, I think, on the second trip of the president. But the few days or a week before, the president was invited directly, not all ASEAN, not even one, but by only him, to speak and engage with Australian Parliament, engage with Australian government, work with and even speak with different policy institutes, which is seen positively by not only Australia, but other countries that would like peace and stability in the region. And side by side with that, Filipinos should also realize there are big investments of Filipino companies in Australia. And their success there redounds to our benefit because those earnings are sent back to the country as profit. No? But we are seeing global initiatives of Filipino companies the past few years, and Australia is an important part of that. And my understanding also, especially in southern Philippines, Australia has been consistent with decades in terms of official development assistance. And more so also the people-to-people relationship that have created opportunities for families to migrate to Australia and vice versa, send remittances to our country. And that's why Australia has been consistent as a top two or top three in our studies on countries that we trust, countries that we hope that will stand up with us as we assert our rights. So Australia is important to the Filipino nation, right, both economically and security-wise.
Right, and it's not just Australia that invited President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. Aside from Germany, as well as the Czech Republic, there are also pending invites from France, I understand also Canada, and other like-minded nations. What kind of message does this send to the global community with regard to the Philippines' position in the geopolitical scheme?
Before the international community, Kat, I'll speak of Filipinos should see the importance of all these trips. We are of strategic value to the global world, and that strategic value was rooted on our victory in 2016. But we are only a country, we are the only country that asserted our rights based on international rules against a bully, which is China. And what makes it different now, this president took that decision and is now asserting it. That means turning that decision into an actual action. And all these countries would like to work with us because they see the importance of the Philippines. When you look at the Philippines, Kat, you look at the map, we have to see the map of the world globally from the side of Pacific Ocean to our east, South China Sea, and even Indian Ocean to our west. And that's basically drives international commerce and trade. the ships. Now we can discuss data flows. All those submarine cables that connect all of us passes through our archipelago. We are a maritime nation. And that, for me, is how this country sees us. Germany is the biggest economy in the EU. That's very important, the invitation. France considers itself a Pacific nation. Now, and even Canada, where a big percentage, I think one of the biggest migrant communities are Filipinos. Imagine this strong ties that we're building. And we're seeing this now with President Marcos. And let's just hope this translates into economic benefits in the long term. These discussions, these visits.
Quite obvious that the Philippines is making a good impression internationally under the Marcos Jr. administration. But what can Malacañang, can the president actually do for that impression to translate not only in economic benefits, but also in actual defense efforts in the West Philippine Sea? Because as far as we're concerned, despite the good name that we are putting out there, Filipino fishermen are still being harassed in our own exclusive economic zone.
If you'd like to step it further, are we ready to ask these countries to have their ships in those exclusive economic zones? Are we ready to ask them more joint patrol in those exclusive economic zones? So that's something also we need to ask ourselves as a nation. For me, I believe that should be the next stage. This maritime cooperation should create opportunities for naval movements in that area of our exclusive economic zone with these countries. Lately, they've been having what we call regular ship visits. But the next stage is really having joint exercise and maybe bring it a little higher level, joint patrols of these exclusive economic zones. That might add to more tension, but that means putting all these words into actual actions from the so-called maritime operations that the president has been offered to by these countries.
And how willing are other countries to actually get themselves involved against Asia's largest economy? That question, the answer to that question remains to be seen.
But why am I quite optimistic? All these countries have something in common. They believe in a rules-based international order. They know China might be a big economy, important to global economics, but what is the use of China's strength if it will be used simply to bully countries within the region? And that might affect the global economy because it will affect also the trade and investments of these countries. So in a rules-based order, that's the only thing that can keep us engaging each other, respecting each other, based on the rules, the international rules as prescribed, and then live peacefully and ensure stability. So I think that's a driving factor of some of these countries.
Right.
Though economically they see value with China, but they wouldn't like China also simply to be more assertive, aggressive, and coercive, especially in this part of the world, which is important in the growth of the global economy.
Right. Dindo, before we let you go, let's talk about the increase in the president's travel fund in 2023. He had 671 million pesos for that travel budget. That number doubled to about 1.15 billion pesos this year. Do you think that amount is actually enough to sustain the president's efforts of going around the world, courting other nations to support the Philippines? Or do you expect a higher number under the National Expenditure Program for 2025?
For me, at the end of the day, you see these expenditures as investments. There's no different from expenditures in the social sector. But the challenge for government today, it translates all this international engagement, as I've said, into number one, helping us assert our national interests vis-a-vis national security. But in the words of the president, national security is economic security. The only value of all these things is when we see these countries not only helping us assert our rights, but also creating opportunities where we turn ourselves into an investment-led growth trajectory. But that cannot happen overnight. That's why us, we look at things in a different point of view. We cannot see it month by month, year by year, but we see this as a six-year presidency, and we need to build on these foundations and really transform our economy working with countries that the president has visited, like-minded countries, to generate jobs and investment in the country and broader trade. That is what I'd like to see in the long term.
All right. We will all have to wait for that to happen, and we will have to...
Yes.
Right. We are in a wait-and-see mode. Thank you so much for joining us this morning and sharing your thoughts, Dindo Manhit of Stratbase ADR Institute.
Thank you.